Yes, I'm Franziska Hinkelmann and I work on V8, so I'll talk about JavaScript engines. I don't need to tell you that JavaScript is everywhere, that it's great for prototyping, small projects, rolling something out quickly, but it also works in enterprise production systems, huge complex frameworks, tons of stuff, everything runs on JavaScript. But I do want to tell you that it's only possible to run complex systems on JavaScript because JavaScript performance is amazing. Here's one number that I found. That's already a few years old, but it said since 2001 and I think 2011, JavaScript performance improved by 100 times. Imagine your React application or your Node server if it were 100 times slower. Nobody would be working with JavaScript. So it's important that JavaScript is this fast, otherwise it wouldn't have come to where it is right now. And of course, the performance of JavaScript is directly related to what the JavaScript engine is doing. So a JavaScript engine is the part that executes your source code. If you have any JavaScript, it doesn't matter whether it's in a browser or Node or IoT, to go from written source code to something that's happening, you always need an engine. So even if you're not aware of it, but all your JavaScript code is run through an engine. I work on V8, that's the engine in Chrome, and it's also in Node.js, but every major browser has their own engine, which is really good because with competition we get even better performance. Just to give you a small overview, so Microsoft Edge has Chakra, there's JavaScript Core in Safari, in Mozilla it's SpiderMonkey. As I said, or as you know, JavaScript's not only restricted to browsers, there's Node.js. Default Node.js comes with V8, but there's a Chakra Node version, and there's also a SpiderMonkey fork. If you're using Electron, that runs on Node and Chromium, so under the hood you have a V8 engine. And then there is smaller engines, smaller in memory, when you have to make a performance trade-off because you're restricted to small IoT devices. So there are things like duct tape or JerryScript. And so since all your code runs on JavaScript engines, I want to give you a little bit of some insight of what's happening under the hood in those engines, because usually you don't see anything there. You just know, oh, if I write code according to tutorials or how I learned it or things I saw, then things are going to happen. But a lot of times you don't think about what is actually happening here, how is my code being executed. We saw this excellent talk yesterday by Arne, who was telling us how you go from dice rolling language to JavaScript, or from CoffeeScript, TypeScript, and so on to JavaScript. And so today we're going from JavaScript to actual machine code. And in general, whenever you compile a language, you start with source code, then you have some kind of parser, a tokenizer, and Alexa that most of the time turn this into an abstract syntax tree. And then you have an interpreter or compiler, another part that takes the abstract syntax tree and converts it into machine code in the end. Because your machines, they cannot execute JavaScript themselves. You need, at some point, those machine instructions. And if you're interested in how the parsing part works, because JavaScript has a lot of really weird quirks with parsing because of how scoping works and things like that, there's an excellent talk from my co-worker, Maya Hölter. And today we're focusing on the second part of that tool chain, we're focusing on the interpreter or the compiler. So a trick that all modern JavaScript engines use to get speed is so-called just-in-time compilation. It's often abbreviated as JIT, so when you hear people talk about JITted code, that means there's a just-in-time compiler. And what that means is that we are compiling the code just in time as we need it. So sometimes people call it lazy compiling because you don't do more than what you need to do. If you write a function but you're never running it, we don't compile it because we never get to the point where we need this function, so it's not compiled. This is different to AOT compilers, ahead of time compilers, where you first compile everything into machine code. And when you're done, you have a standalone executable that you can ship and run then. So in C++, you compile, you wait a while, you get a result, and you can run that on different machines. In JavaScript, you always have to send to source code. There's no separate thing between compiling and running. It happens at the same time, and we're switching back and forth between compile a little bit, run it, recompile, run some more, and so on. So this simple graph gets a little more complicated for just-in-time compilers. We're basically getting a loop here. It's not compile and then run the result. It's compile, run, back and forth. And the modern engines, what they do in addition to just-in-time compilation is they all have at least one optimizing compiler. So they have a baseline compiler that's compiling, running, but they also have an optimizing compiler. And the job of the optimizing compiler is it to make functions that are run a lot of time, so-called hot functions, to be even faster. So the baseline compiler compiles as fast as possible, even if the result is not super fast machine code, but just because otherwise you would wait forever for the compilation. But then the optimizing compiler says, well, if a particular function is being executed all the time, it's totally worth to put in more upfront cost of compiling it into something better. So, and this is the part where it's important that we switch all the time between running and compiling, because only when you run code can you figure out that some function is hot. When you just have the source code, you don't know which functions will be executed a lot. You have to run it and keep track of, oh, I'm running this foo function all the time, let's optimize it. So that's why it's important to switch back and forth between compiling and running. Okay, so in a graph, the simple picture, you start with source code, you parse this, you get an abstract syntax tree, then there is a baseline compiler that generates machine code, and hot functions are fed into the optimizing compiler that's also generating machine code, but this code now executes faster than the one on the left-hand side. And you see this red arrow here, so there are certain cases where when we have the optimized code, we are unfortunately forced to bail out and to de-optimize and go back to the slow part. I'll tell you more about that. Since I work on V8, specifically in V8, the baseline compiler is an interpreter. It's called Ignition, and it generates bytecode. And our optimizing compiler is called Turbofan. This is our brand new compiler pipeline. We just turned it on this year, so we completely retired our old optimizing compiler that we had since 2010. So if you have new versions of Chrome, you're already using this new pipeline. If you use Node.js, if you wait a little bit for an older version of Node 8, which just came out yesterday, it will also always run with this new pipeline. But all the other big engines also have optimizing compilers. So in SpiderMonkey, that's IonMonkey. In Safari, they actually have two optimizing compilers. They have a DFG for functions that are hot, and then they have FTL for functions that are super hot, I guess. So they crank out even more speed by tearing up the optimization compilers. And Chakra also has an optimizing compiler, the full JIT compiler. Okay, so you might wonder, how does it actually help if we do more work here, if we're recompiling, if we're switching all the time? How can this be efficient? How did this get us from you use JavaScript to make a few changes on your website in 1995 or 2001 to here's a full-blown React framework or Node application? I'm gonna try to use a very simple example to make this all a little more concrete. So it's a very basic function, add, it takes an object, and it returns 1 plus object at A. And even more simple than that, I just want to focus on the addition operator. So the function itself is a little silly. You wouldn't write that in production code, but I'm sure you have pluses all over really real code. So this is not made up or anything. And addition or string concatenation happens a lot, so this is something we do all the time. And it is all over our code. It's a very small, innocent-looking operator. You might assume, well, that's fairly little work for a compiler to add two numbers or to concatenate two strings. But if you look at the specification, then these 10 steps here describe in detail what the addition operator is doing. And it's not important that you read these 10 steps. I just want to show you how much that is, because all of these steps have other functions that they're calling that in turn have lots of steps of things that need to be checked and calculated. So when you do addition, you have to call toPrimitive, or you have to call toString, and you have to call value of if you strictly follow the specification. And all engines do follow the specification. Modulo little bugs. But we followed a specification because otherwise you could never run any JavaScript code if everybody just did what they felt sort of works, kind of. So as a compiler to be useful at all, you have to follow exactly these steps when you see the addition operator. And my coworker actually in an older talk went through the trouble of laying this all out. So this is the full blown tiny little plus symbol that's actually going on. And I think this is kind of cute. The actual specification is so complicated that there is a note here. The addition operator either performs string concatenation or numeric addition. So we all knew that, but you can't see it from looking at the specification. That's how convoluted it is. So that's why there is this note in here. So whenever you have an A plus B in your code, the compiler has to do all of this, which in terms of performance is really sad, because it's like this super long list of things to go through. But if you think about it, if you do integer plus integer, that's basically what machines are being built for. I mean, it's not binary representation, but this is something that computer hardware is really fast in dealing with. Like, this should not be frowny face. If you're adding floating point numbers, that's a little more complicated. And we know there's weird rounding error thingies going on in JavaScript, but still adding floating point numbers is something that machines are good at. String concatenation, yes, there's encoding involved, and it's not as simple as just converting numbers to binary representation and adding up the bits. But it's still very simple. There's no crazy memory layout. There's no interacting with the file system or anything. This should be short tasks for a machine. It should not be, oh, this maze of craziness that's in the specification. So in our compilers, to go from sad face to happy face, since we have a JIT compiler, we can leverage the fact that adding integers is so much easier than doing a plus between unknown things in JavaScript. So let's look at this code here. We're calling the add function that just has a plus in it. The very first time we call it, since we have a lazy JIT compiler, the very first time, we first need to compile our code. So when we see this and we compile the addition operator, then it's fairly slow because we have to do all these like super long steps according to the spec. And then when we run these functions a lot of times, eventually we say, hey, this is a hot function. It makes sense to optimize this. And when we ran it, we noticed those have always been integers in our case. So it just happened to be in our code that we're always adding up numbers because it's representing the age of users or something like that. So we have the information, it's integers, and we're adding them. So why do everything that's in the spec? Let's just do a very simple integer addition that is easy in machine code. So we pass this on to TurboFan, the optimizing compiler. It's regenerating the code, pretending that it always will see integers, because that's what it's seen all the time in the past. So when we run it again, it's like, yay, now we can just do adding up those registers instead of figuring out if things have a toString method attached to them and calling toValue and so on. Now, what's the problem with this? I mean, it's JavaScript. Just because you did something a few times, there's no contract with the language that you can completely change your mind and that the data or the parameters to your function are different. Nobody's stopping you from calling this with a string. This fast machine code that we generated is specifically relying on the fact that at this memory address of the parameters that it has an integer, because that's what it's then doing. So if you put in a string, you would not get the string concatenation that we want. So in this case, we have to start over. We have to go back to the specification, figure out what do we do if something is a string, call to string on it, and then end up with concatenation. So in our schematic of how the compiler works, the AST is fed into Ignition, or Ignition is consuming the abstract syntax tree. And when we call add, we compile this code into bytecode. When we call add many times, then we pass this on to TurboFan. And TurboFan will now optimize the machine code. And the important part here is that it's optimizing using the feedback, the information that we collected. So only because we know that it's always been this one type of inputs, we can use this to generate optimized code. And then when the type is changing, when we're not calling it with integers anymore, that's when we have to go back to the bytecode. So JavaScript engines, they can use the type information that they collect at runtime to speed up performance, because they collect type information and they use it to generate better machine code. And it goes back and forth, run a few times, collect information, generate code that's good for this kind of information, and assume things are not changing too much, so you actually make progress by using this optimized code. So that's for types, like integers, so we distinguish between small integers, doubles, strings, objects, arrays, but that only gets us so far. I mean, in reality, it would be nice if our code is just adding up a few numbers, but it's mostly very complex objects. And if you do type of object, that will always just tell you object. So that doesn't help us a lot to distinguish or to generate code specifically for all kinds of objects. Conveniently, this example has an object in it. I'm using 1 plus object.a, so I'm loading a named property of object. And that's another thing that we speed up. So why would this be complicated? Why would we need to do something special for object.a? If you do a simple property lookup, or let's say if you do a property lookup, you assume it's simple because it's all over the code. It's just a dot. It's the most common thing in JavaScript. But there's a lot of things that could happen. This could throw a type error. The object might not have this property. The object might not have an own property, but it might be on the prototype chain. If the object is a proxy with a get handler, then whatever is defined there needs to happen. A might be an accessor descriptor, so it can have arbitrary side effects. So really, from a machine point of view, it's not simple to just get this A value from object. In our case, we knew, oh, the A value is just 1 or 17 or something. But from a machine's perspective, that is something really hard to know because of how JavaScript is defined. So again, in the specification for an ordinary get, which is already a narrowed down thing of looking up a property, it's multiple steps. And hidden in here is recursion, because you have to walk up the prototype chain. There's calls in there. So from a machine point of view, this is a lot of work. It's not just looking at it and saying, oh yeah, it's 17. So the trick that we're doing here is, again, that we collect information while we run this code to later make it better. So if we run the add function the first time we run it, we have to do all the slow steps, because otherwise it would just not be correct. But once we figure that out, we memorize the information that we just figured out was a lot of hard work. So we put into a cache what we just found out, and what we put into this cache is the shape of our objects and a shortcut or a path of how to get to the value. So we're not saving into the cache this object and the value is 42. We're saving objects shaped like this. This is how you get the value. So internally in V8, for most simple objects, their properties are just at a specific offset to the address of the object. So if you think about the object laid out in memory, and then you assume, oh, the properties are all next to each other, so with an offset from the object you get there, more complicated objects that's different, but that is one case of where the property is. So if you realized, if you look up a property for one object that looks like this, and you say, oh, this is always in this storage of the object, it's at this offset position, and you see other objects that have the same shape, then we know internally for that object, the memory layout is the same. So by just using the value at that offset, we get the correct value for other objects, but objects that have the same shape. Okay, so we're saving this into a cache, and we associate the cache with this call side of the property lookup. So when we call this function again, this time, the first thing we do is we check the cache whether we already have an entry. And you see, these are not the same objects. I mean, 42 and 7 are not the same. They're not the same objects, but they look very much the same. They are object literals with just one property. I didn't mess with the prototype. And in fact, internally in V8, they are the same. We do consider them having the same shape. So we found a matching entry in our cache, and we can just use the shortcut to get the property, which namely is it's at this offset. It's not, oh, look up this, maybe throw a type error, go to the prototype chain, look up these things. It's like, it's right there. So we don't have to do all these steps. I hope you get a feeling for how doing this shortcut to get the property saves you a lot of time if you do it millions and millions over instead of just following this long, complicated specification every single time you do object.a. And these caches have a special name. They're called inline caches. That's mostly for historical reasons. They're not actually inline anymore, but we still call them inline caches or ICs because conceptually they're an inline cache. And we actually have an inline cache for every separate call site. So these two call sites of a property lookup, even though it's the same object and one function of the very same property, internally they have completely separate inline caches. And just a little bit of lingo, I keep saying shape of an object. We call them maps, and sometimes they're referred to as hidden classes. And so an inline cache is a cache that maps to how to get to the property quickly. If you're playing around with this and you want to understand when are two things actually, from V8's point of view, the same shape, so this is something V8 specific. It's not defined by the specification. It's not exactly the same in the other engines, but conceptually they do something very similar. But if you do want to figure it out just for V8, because either you're curious or you work with Node.js, so you know you do have V8, you can actually look that up yourself for two objects. You can use so-called intrinsic methods. Those are V8 helper methods that you can use, not in production, but sometimes to understand things. You use a syntax that is not JavaScript. It's just made up V8, so you have a little percentage sign in front of it, and you see the IDE actually complains that this is an error. And of course, this doesn't run if you just run it because it's not JavaScript, but you can pass in a flag when you run Chrome or Node to allow the specific syntax. So if you're interested in this and you read about it and you're like, well, I want to check if my intuition is right, if those things are really are the same shape of objects for V8, you can actually try it out yourself. Okay, so we have the interpreter that is generating bytecode, then the we identified a function as hot, so TurboFan is optimizing the code. And in addition to this type information that we were always adding integers, TurboFan is also using that feedback that we collected about the hidden classes. When it's generating this super fast machine code, or hopefully super fast machine code, it's using the information we collected about what were the objects looking like. And again, if we change the shape of the objects, so in this case, it's still integers. The plus would work well, but getting the property x, the object now has a different memory layout, so we cannot just use that same shortcut. So we have to de-optimize again to go to the slower bytecode. Here's actually what the bytecode itself looks like. So some nitty-gritty details, I hope you followed until here, but if you did and you want to dig even deeper, this is the bytecode that Ignition is generating for the function add. So first, when we start, we have to do a stack check. That's something you have to do when you enter a function. And then we call load small integer. We were doing 1 plus something. So we're loading the small integer 1 into our accumulator register. The next instruction is store into R0, store the value that is currently in the accumulator into register 0. So we have a 1 stored away in this register. And then we do load the property, load this named property of our parameter A0. So A's are the parameters. A0 is the first parameter. That's the object. And we want to get its property. So that's when we're loading whatever the value of that parameter is in the accumulator. And then we do the actual plus operator, the addition. So we're adding the value in R0 to the accumulator, so 42 plus 1. Okay. So that's bytecode for this. It's very short bytecode for an even shorter function. But this bytecode, this is not machine code. So the machine code for this bytecode is what you see on the left-hand side. And this actually runs on for pages and pages, because it's really the bytecode that's representing this maze of instructions in the specification. Like, if you're just reading the specification, you'd be busy for quite a while. So I mean, the specification just for the addition operator. So the machine code that this short snippet of bytecode is translated to is actually pages long. Now, on the right-hand side, these 4 lines are the optimized code for the add function when the add function has always been fed with this 1 kind of object. Real quick, on the right-hand side, the optimized code, first we do comp. That's a comparison. We are comparing the maps, making sure we get the kind of object that we're expecting. We're checking the map of the input. If it's not the shape of object that we can work with, then we bail out. We de-optimize. That's our red arrow going back to the slow bytecode. That would get us back to the left-hand long side. If it is the right shape, if it is the shape for which we optimized, then we move the named property value into a register, and then we just add 1 to that register, and we're done with it. So you see the right-hand side is a lot less work, and if you're doing something like this in loops over and over, this really does save up a lot of time for you. So I hope conceptually I was able to give you some understanding of what the engines are doing under the hood. It's probably a little academic, but engines are there all the time when we do JavaScript, and I think it's fun to know a little bit about the underlying system. And maybe sometimes that kind of understanding will even help you to understand weird performance behaviors or give you an idea sometimes why something could never be very fast if it's done that way. And you might have seen performance advice like this that tells you to not use specific patterns in V8. But all of this is not valid anymore because that was specifically for old pipeline, the crankshaft optimizing compiler. So I said we switched out this year the compiler pipeline, and TurboFan that does not have any specific patterns or keywords that you can't use because it would make it bail out all the time. So the only advice that I have for you is, because of the just-in-time compilation and the hidden classes and the inline caches, and because that is also used across all the engines, if you write code that looks statically typed in nature, that is the most helpful for JavaScript engines. Or by doing this, you're not forcing the engines to fall back on the de-optimizing, to fall back on the slower baseline compiler all the time. So statically typed in nature is best for JavaScript engines in terms of performance. Thank you. Ooh, the couch.
To the couch.
To the couch.
That was fascinating. I have many questions. The audience had many questions, too. Here's one that I lost my questions. Yeah. So one question was, you mentioned especially static type systems at the end. How close are we to letting V8 use some of the type hinting information from stuff like TypeScript or Flow or other systems like that? Is that on the radar at all, or
so
something similar to that?
The types in TypeScript or in Flow, they are unfortunately not exactly the same types as the maps in V8. So in Flow, you say only allow objects here that have property A. But just because objects have this property does not mean that they have the same memory layout in V8, because they might have more properties that might even be in some backing store or something like that. But if you do use TypeScript, at least your chances that your code is more in line with what the engine expects are better than if you would write code that you can't even annotate because you're all over the place.
So it can't use the information directly, but you're not going to pass in like a string instead of an object sometimes.
Right, so
hopefully.
That already helps you because TypeScript is then forcing you to write code like that.
Is there any work into types that map more closely to the engine types? Do you know anything about that? That might be...
It just wouldn't really work with the memory layout. Mm-hmm. But we do look, of course, at code that is being used a lot on the web. And so since a lot of people use TypeScript, the code that it compiles to is something that we see a lot and that mm-hmm. we see in our benchmarks. And so we try to optimize for specific patterns there. But
sure,
we're not using it directly, the type information.
Sure, that makes sense. Another question was, so why don't we just compile the JavaScript ahead of time if it gets compiled already? Why not do that and ship the compiled code down instead of the raw JavaScript?
Because of how JavaScript is defined, it's dynamically typed. So just by looking at the code, you never know what inputs you will get. So in other languages, that works really, really well. You can optimize the heck out of C++ ahead of time because it's very clear for the compiler what the object memory structure is and what the inputs to function are. So it can use all this information ahead of time. But in JavaScript, because we have this freedom and it's great for prototyping and you have the ability to deck type, the compiler is lacking all this information. And some of the information, or most of the information, we only get at runtime. That's why we always have to switch between compiling and running.
That makes sense. So you need the runtime information. You
yes,
can't just...
Yes.
Yeah. Okay.
No, it's not because we're lazy. It's because we just don't have it.
That was the subtext of the question. Are you just lazy? what about WebAssembly? How does that fit into this world? Does that make sense even? I don't know
so
that much about WebAssembly. This is an audience question, so...
Internally, WebAssembling is using the same TurboFan compiler that we use for JavaScript code. WebAssembly is compiled ahead of time just because we want to get this fast performance. But yeah.
OK, that makes sense. You mentioned at the end this list of performance tips that are kind of outdated now in V8 specifically. I think that's a theme in general with JavaScript performance. There's lots of apocryphal knowledge about like, use double equals, no, triple equals. I saw this JS perf benchmark. Use plus plus, not the post increment. Or so how do you keep up as a JavaScript engineer with, I mean, at some point, some of this might have been true, and it might not be anymore. Some of it is maybe never has been true, but just because benchmarks are weird, it looks true. Like, how do I, as a humble JavaScript developer, keep up with what I should actually do?
That's a great question, and I should have mentioned that you should be very, very careful with performance advice, and that you should not optimize prematurely, and that you should measure really careful when you optimize. If you really do have to optimize on these levels, then it's your job to keep up with blog posts and making your own benchmarks and all that to make sure the advice you heard some time ago is still valid. It's also important to point out if you hear this extremely specific engine advice, if something is on some micro benchmark faster in V8, it might actually end up being slower in Safari, things like that. Mm-hmm. So be careful there, because you never know where your clients, where your users are running your code. What was the other part of the question?
I think that was that the was only it. Part. Yeah, okay. You answered it.
So general advice is don't optimize on that level, because lots of other things are much, much having a much bigger impact on the performance of your app anyways. Like, what resources you're loading and the round trips to the server make a much bigger difference than how you're adding two numbers together on the engine level. in Node.js Core, we have some performance improvements where people really measure specifically. And in Node, you know it's V8 and you know the version. And then we have a few pieces of Node internals where the code is really, really tuned to V8, and it's not comprehend, like it makes it harder to read and to maintain, but we did it for performance reasons. But with those things, it's important that you go back regularly with the V8 updates and check whether this is even still needed or maybe even slowing it down now.
So what you're saying is when I manually unruled all my multiplications to additions
please
in a
don't.
For loop, don't do that. Shoot.
For your future, you and other developers in your team, please don't.
Okay.
And for performance reasons, don't do it either.
But it looks cool. I think one last question then is, one of the themes I got from the talk was also there's a lot of work happening behind the scenes in the engine to keep track of type information and statistics about how often a function is run. How do you balance the overhead in memory and speed of measuring and keeping track versus the gains you get from doing the more advanced optimization work? Does that make sense?
We measure and try out different approaches and measure again. And I think Benedict's talk will go much more into what we measure and benchmark, so I leave that up to him. But
awesome.
It's always a trade-off, and we try out different things and sometimes make changes and sometimes throw them away.
That was a perfect segue. Thank you so much for your talk. That was fascinating.
Thank you.